Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 157 of the RRBG podcast. As we are all still living under the pandemic lockdown, a lot of our sponsors are unable to provide promo codes. However, a lot of them are still open and providing special pricing. So I wanted to give a shout out to some of our sponsors. Please check out Thunderking Coffee. Go to thunderkingcoffee.com. They're selling all of their coffee at wholesale price right now, and they ship all over the U.S. Also, check out Saints Joints. Go to saintsjoints.com. They're currently selling 100% CBD joints available for shipping across the U.S. wherever it's legal. And you can support them by picking up some merch as well. I also want to give a shout out to Hella Hot Hot Sauce. They're shipping as well. So please make sure to go to their website, hellahothotsauce.com, and pick some up today. And I wanted to give a special shout out to our buddies over at Cosmic Eye Brewing. Breweries are especially struggling during these times since they are unable to sell kegs to these restaurants and bars that are closed down. But they are still open and making beers. If you're in the Nebraska area, you can stop by for pickup. Or go to their website, cosmiceye.beer, and check out all the merchandise they have available online for purchase. And you can order online for pickup as well. In this episode, I talked to the legendary Mike Williams of I Hate God. I caught up with him during the quarantine to talk about the new I Hate God record. I asked him what he's been doing with his time during the stay-at-home rules. We talk a little bit about his struggles with drug addiction and the liver transplant. And we shared a few stories. I had a great time talking to him. The man's a legend. Please check him out online. Please check out the spoken word video he put up on Cult Nation. And pick up one of the I Hate God records to support. Don't forget to check out Patreon. Go to patreon.com/RRBG to support this podcast. And I hope you're all being smart and staying safe. Stay home. Cheers.
Hello.
Hey, Mike, what's up?
Hey, what's happening, man? What's going on?
Not much, brother, not much. Getting situated here.
I hear you, man. what is your podcast? This is the PPBG, is the name of it?
RRBG, which is...
RR.
It used to be Rock and Roll Beer Guy, but a lot of my...
Oh, that's you.
Yeah.
Oh, man, we've been trying to do an interview with each other. Well, not with each other, but we've been trying to do this for a while, right?
Yeah.
I talked to you a long time ago. Yeah.
Yeah, I hit you up a couple of years ago, and ever since then, I changed it to just RRBG, shorten it up, and also a lot of people were getting scared when I would hit them up and like, hey, I'm the Rock and Roll Beer Guy. They're like, I don't drink beer. I'm like, well, it doesn't have to be about beer, dude.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, mm-hmm. I'm just it had nothing to do with that for me. I'm just a terrible procrastinator, so I, you know. that's my problem.
It's funny, I brought it up with a couple buddies, you know, mutual friends of ours that I think like Danny Walker and a couple of the homies. Mm. I'm like, yeah, I'm trying to hit up Mike for a podcast, and they're like, man, you know, I'm surprised he's using Instagram. I would figure he'd stay away from the social media and shit.
Oh, really? No, man, I use that stuff to the fullest, to be honest, man. Nice. I'm like posting shit every day because that's how you do it these days, you know?
Oh,
old school, super old school, but yeah, you know, I'm no spring chicken, you know, but I use that stuff, and that's how people find out about your band or whatever you're doing, you know? I mean,
yeah.
I don't go in there. I don't post pictures of food and shit, you know, but I post, you know, when there's a show or something, you know, that get like that.
Jimmy does. Jimmy posts food. I've seen him posting some food.
Yeah, he drives me fucking, he drives me crazy with that, man. he'll post a picture of like two baked potatoes like on a paper plate. I'm like, dude, that's not like food. That's not what people want to see, man.
Hashtag they want to see food
like
porn.
Some glamorous. Yeah, that's not food porn. That's like they want to see some glamorous, colorful meal, and you got like two dry ass baked potatoes on there.
Oh, shit. Yeah, man.
I love him, though. I love Jimmy. I love him. I'm just fucking with him. Yeah.
Yeah, Jimmy's the man, dude. And like, you know, I'm really, I got a lot of response from that podcast. A lot of people really enjoyed it. So
Killer, man. That's good, man. Jimmy's a good person, you know.
Hell yeah, dude. How are you doing with this whole, you know, quarantine business, staying at home?
I'm actually fine with staying away from humans, man. It's it's really like actually what I've always wanted. But I mean, you know, I'm just dealing with it like everybody else. You know, there's not much else you can do. But, you know, I'm doing the right thing, though, and just staying away from people and wearing the mask and all that. It blows my mind, these people. I know this is a big topic of everybody's conversation, but the people that aren't taking precautions and are just walking around without, you know, even thinking about it, it's kind of crazy to me. I'd rather just stay away from all that. And
a lot of musicians that I've talked to, you know, they're all the same. They're like, hey man, I've been social distancing this whole time, you know, because we just stay home and write music and record, and like, you know, we're not really out unless we're on tour, you know.
Yeah, but, yeah, that's exactly what it is. I mean, I hate God was going to take this time off anyway. Like, we've been touring for like 3 years straight, basically. And we were going to take the rest of this year off because I have vocals to do for the new record. And that this was supposed to be the time to do that, you know, but there's like, now the studios are closed. And it's been really hard to figure all that out, but it'll get done sooner, you know, hopefully sooner than later. But so, yeah, when we're not on tour, we're at home anyway. I don't go out. I don't do anything when I'm not on tour. So this is fine with me, you know.
Yeah, man. Yeah, I do. So, you know, financially, though, I mean, is Eyehategod in a position to where, you know, the majority of your income is coming from tour, or like, do you have, you know, money saved up from all the years of being in the band, or do you have a side thing, you know?
I mean, I can't speak for everybody else, but I try to save, you know, all these years. I mean, that's how you make money, is by saving money, you know what I mean? So I'm pretty well off right now, you know, as far as that goes. I mean, of course I'm, you know, applying for these programs that you know, like Music Cares, and there's a bunch of relief programs that can help also. But yeah, man, I mean, I'm pretty sure everybody in the band's okay. I mean, Gary was the only one, our bass player Gary's the only one that like has a real job for like the past, I don't think me or Jimmy have worked in 25-30 years or something. I don't know, but I mean, off and on, but yeah, Gary's got a job, and I forgot the question, but yeah.
No, yeah, the question was that, like, are you guys good enough, you know, to not be on tour right now and be okay, you know, because a lot of bands are struggling, a lot of people in the industry, not just bands, but like crew, you know, stage hands, backline people, all that, everybody's hurting, so.
Yeah, I mean, it can't last much longer, you know. I mean, everybody can be comfortable for a little bit, but all these, like I said, the relief programs will help. But I really feel bad for, you know, all the workers that make the shows happen, you know. Like you just said, like the roadies and the tour managers and the merch people and lighting guys and stagehands and all that stuff. It's just I'm hoping that people are getting some of these relief programs and getting the unemployment thing and all that, you know, because if this keeps going on and on, which that's the thing about it all. It's just very uncertain right now. Nobody knows what's going to happen. You know, I mean, there's like, you know, rumors that it could be over this date or whatever. But I mean, I don't know. I think it's going to be a while myself personally. It seems like it could be a bit. So I hope everybody's just getting help and is saving their pennies, you know, for what could come.
Yeah, man. Yeah. And, you know, a lot of people are adapting. I've seen, like, you know, people building out studios in their home, people, you know, getting shit up on, like, streaming websites so you can do stuff online and try and make money that way, like Twitch streaming or streaming on YouTube or something, you know.
It's definitely going to change everything, I think, for a long time, if not forever. You know, I mean, things, the way things are done, and there's no way to say what it's going to be like, you know. But like you said, there's more people are figuring out how to do these things from home and just some kind of remote type of recording or broadcasting or whatever, you know.
It's you know, it's, I see it similar to like the old, you know, you said yourself, you're an old schooler, but you adapted to social media. Like before, you know, when you were in Eyehategod in the first place, there was no social media, so you had to adapt to that kind of, you know, technology to push the band, because like you said, it's the best way to get your music out there. So I feel like this is another one of those moments in time where people need to transition over to something new and like adapt, you know.
Yeah, I mean, that's what humans are supposed to be able to do to survive, is adapt, you know. I mean, things change all the time and you have to adapt, you know.
Yeah, man. Are you considered immune system like compromised because of the whole because you had your liver transplant, right?
Yeah, I had a liver transplant. Yeah.
Does that like affect you in that way where like your immune system's compromised as well?
Well, I have to take immunosuppressants to keep, like from rejecting everything. But the thing is that medicine is actually, it's actually good for the system in this situation, because when the COVID virus attacks your body, your immune system overreacts and overworks to fight it. My immune system's a little bit, I guess I'm not sure if I can explain it totally correctly, but my immune system won't react like that. It won't go over the top fighting the virus or whatever. It would, now I'm losing track of what I'm trying to say. There's a thing called a cytokine storm that. Yeah, I just totally blew your mind. I know. I don't know what I'm talking about either, but actually, it just means that it's just people's immune system would overreact, and that's what could cause your whole system to fail, you know. So,
right.
But mine, I think this medicine keeps my immune system lower than most people. So, I know it sounds weird, but.
Well, I'm just hoping, you know, I'm just asking because I was, you know, I know this is like a big deal right now with the virus. Like, are you staying safe and healthy and, you know, making sure
of
that?
Of course.
Yeah,
all that. I mean, I don't, like I said, I don't really go around humans anyway. I don't really like to, you know, I'm not that type of person, you know. I mean, we have to, when we go on tour, we're around lots of people, and if you're on a tour bus or something, you're around a lot of people. But I prefer to just, I like to be isolated, so that makes me happy, you know. There's a few people I like to hang out with, and that's really it, you know.
Yeah,
but
sure,
of course I'm staying safe and taking all the precautions.
That's awesome. Yeah, you know, I got very concerned, you know, when the whole thing went down with you and the liver transplant. I remember, you know, posting about it and seeing the news and sharing it with people. And I'm like, man, this sucks. And then almost immediately after you got the surgery, you went back on the road. I remember seeing you.
Yeah.
And I went with Adam D from Killswitch. We went to go see you guys in San Diego. And I was just like, I can't believe he's on stage right now. This is crazy.
Yeah, it was 4 months after... 4 months after the surgery, I was back on stage.
Fuck, man.
I mean, that's
crazy.
I mean, I felt fine enough to do it, you know? That's, you know, just, I mean, that's one thing that kept me going when things were looking pretty down, you know, when things were at their worst, you know, there for before the surgery, you know?
Yeah,
because obviously it took a time. It took a while. Like, you have to get on a list and wait. There's a waiting list for this thing. You know, you have to find. They have to find the right organ for your body and all these things. So you know, it's a sketchy time, you know? And I mean, that's life too. You know what I mean? I mean, people die, you know, it's like, it's not a special thing. I mean, everyone dies. So someday we're all going to die. So it's like, that was just a time that I happened to fight it, you know? And, I just kept staying positive through thinking about getting back on stage and making music again. And all the people on Facebook and Instagram and stuff too. Also, speaking of social media again, like all those people really helped keep my spirits up too, as far as like, you know, just sending any stupid message about, you know, just, you know, hang in there or whatever, you know, all that stuff like really helped me. I appreciate all those people and thank them very much.
Wow, man. Yeah, it was a crazy time, at least for me, because, you know, I've been a fan from the beginning, and it's, you know, it's just like those type of scenarios are never good. And, like, you know, obviously, like you said, everybody dies, and that's kind of how I've lived my life, too. You know, just every time people get sad that, you know, someone passes, I'm like, hey, man, it's the one inevitable thing is that we're not immortal, right?
Yeah, I mean, exactly. You know, I think more other people look at it. I just kind of look at it as like a part of life. Like that happened to me, and it's over now. It's like nothing. I don't even really think about it ever. I mean, it doesn't register as some like high crazy point in my life. It's just like something that else that happened that on the road to surviving in this crazy human body that we're all given, you know, in the world.
Yeah, man. And you've been through a lot of shit too. Not just that, but like, you know, you had the deal that, you know, with Hurricane Katrina that it went down and, you know, all the other, you know, stuff that you've gone through. It's just, you know, it's part, like you said, it's part of life having to survive this kind of crazy shit. And this is just another one of those things, this virus, you know, another one of those crazy things life throws at you.
Yeah. I was saying the other day, this is like my second apocalyptic situation after Katrina. You know, that was New Orleans, you know, looked like The Walking Dead basically after that happened. So this is like another scenario like that, which is pretty crazy, you know. But I mean, everybody gets different things thrown at them in life, and I just happen to have that set of things. And what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. So it's just,
fuck yeah.
You know, I'm just always, I just for some reason was built in my mind to survive and fight all these things, you know, and keep moving on. And I've never been one to, of course, you know, I've been suicidal and things like that. But you get out of that and you just want to, something kicks in your brain and you just decide, you're like, yeah, I want to live, you know, I want to keep pushing this thing as far as it'll go. If nothing else, just to annoy other people, you know, so I'm good with that.
Yeah, man. Have you been writing? Like, I know you have a couple books out. Have you been writing more during this time?
I've been writing. I write all the time. Like, just, it's not like a set thing where I sit down to write or anything. I just, like, if something pops in my head, you know. And now, you know, with the new technology, like now it's like I pull out my phone, you know, and write something on my phone.
Right, yeah.
Just, but I mean, there's also, I write on scraps of paper and whatever else, you know. I mean, it's just whatever there is. But yeah, I'm always writing constantly. I just did a spoken word thing last night. I don't know if you checked that out on the Cult Nation website. I did like a little spoken word piece thing. I've been doing that for years too, like just spoken word stuff. And then I did the that band Corrections House that I was in. It was like a kind of a, I guess you'd call it industrial, experimental noise kind of thing. But
yeah, it has dudes from Neurosis and Yakuza and.
Yeah. Scott Kelly from Neurosis and Bruce from Yakuza and Sanford Parker, who's worked with everybody from Chris Connolly from, you know, Revolting Cox and like just all, you know, it was a fun thing that we did for a while there, but that was kind of more along that spoken word writing thing for me, you know, that was my part in that band. I also played synthesizer in the band, which was fun.
Nice. So, Have you thought about writing like a novel? Because I know you know the stuff, the books you have been more like biographical and you know, lyrics from the band and stuff like that. But
it's been all just like lyrics and poetry type stuff. That's all I've written, you know.
Yeah.
You mean a novel like
a story,
fiction?
Or yeah.
Like fiction. I mean, I've thought of it. You know, I wrote like short stories. You know, like stuff that I've never like put out there or anything. But I don't know. So many people want like to write a biography about me and the band. Obviously, me and the band and Jimmy and everybody. We've thought about putting this book out for ages. And we just never had anybody serious, really. We've had some offers that just weren't serious or they didn't pan out. But we want to do, like, a nice book with all... I mean, we've had some pretty cool fucking graphics, I think, over the years. If you go on our website, there's at the bottom of the screen, there's all of our posters and flyers from, like, 30 years worth of shows, like, scrolling on the bottom. And there's just stuff like that we want to put in it, like, flyers and stories from each member of the band and all and stuff like that. But we just need somebody serious to like get on it, you know, and help us do it. Cause we're not just going to sit and write this book and put it out, you know?
Right. Right.
But I plan on writing more poetry books too, or more, who knows what I'll put out next. I'm planning on putting something out, trying to just compile a bunch of things and edit stuff down. The editing's what takes forever, and then just, you know, get published something. It could be short stories, it could be the poetry stuff. I call it dark negative poetry because it's not really it's not like, you know, Walt Whitman or anything, but it's still hopefully it's powerful to people. So yeah,
I think so, man. And, you know, there's always a room for that kind of thing. Like, you know, obviously you look at I don't know if you can consider, I guess you could consider like Edgar Allan Poe a poet, and, you know, all that dark and gothic shit that he would write. So, and that's like, you know, very big. It's popular. You go to Barnes and Nobles, there's giant collections of his work and TV shows based on it. So.
Well, I love Edgar Allan Poe. You know, I mean, there's other writers like Charles Bukowski was a big influence on me. William Burroughs and Clive Barker, even.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, there's so many. There's tons of writers. William Vollman, Kurt Vonnegut. There's so many different writers that have influenced me, and that it's just another part of the art to me, you know. Like, I wouldn't say, like, oh, I'm an artist. I think that's kind of silly for people to say, but it's part of what we do as a band, you know, and as people. I mean, like, Eyehategod is a band. It's an entity in its own right, but each member does so many other different things, you know? Like, Aaron plays in, like, four other bands. He was in a band called Gas Miasma, which is, like, a crust punk band, and The Missing Monuments was like kind of a garage pop band. He's in a band called Weather Warlock, which is like experimental. Jimmy's, of course, in Everything Down, Super Join. I don't know if that exists, but he was a drummer in Corrosion Conformity, you know. So, and Gary's got other bands, other projects that he does, Hogjaw and a band called Class Hole. So we're all, you know, we all got our hands in other things, and this just happens to be what I do. I also do an experimental noise band right now, but obviously we can't do anything. We did one show with my friend Chris Brokaw, but there's just so much going on, so much to do. When you feel creative, you know, it's just like it's an outlet that you have to take as far as you can, is what I think.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. And it's best to take advantage of it. You know, I nothing pisses me off more than having creative friends that don't do anything with it. Like, I have friends that I know are insanely talented, that, you know, started maybe a band or something in their early days, but now are just working like construction or, you know, in an office or something. You know, and obviously that's like essential type work that needs to be done.
Sure.
But if you're so creative and like you have this talent, like really, you know, put it to use.
Yeah, I mean, of course, everybody goes through those periods, too. I mean, I've been through periods where I didn't do anything, you know, and I'm just kind of stagnating and thinking of all these creative ideas in my head, but just not being motivated to put them out there. I mean, that's just a part of being a person, I guess, you know, sometimes, the system gets to you, you know, you get down on everything, but, sometimes I don't understand that people, they'll put out a great record or they'll have a great band and then it'll just fade away and they just don't really care anymore. But it was like an excellent fucking band, you know?
Yeah.
But some people's priorities are different and everybody it takes a certain person really to go live in a van for months and months at a time, you know?
Yeah. That lifestyle is rough, man. It's not healthy. It's not conductive to your health. And, you know, especially you end up falling into bad vices, man. Like, I know you've had your troubles with it in the past and, when I was on tour with my band, like I was just constantly drinking and smoking and I felt like shit every day. And, you know,
what was your band? What was the name of
your band? We were Dissever and we were like a metal band out of Miami. And we would tour and, you know, I'd wake up hungover and like the best solution is have a beer. That'll make you feel better.
Of course.
You know what I mean?
Well, yeah, I mean, that's, you know, but if you look at a lot of older bands like us and like we just got off a tour with Napalm Death. Mm-hmm. And you see, like, there are ways to tour and stay away from that stuff. It's not easy, but you can, or if you do drink, you know, just try to moderate it or just, you know, it's not easy. It's not easy at all, you know. Yeah, I've gotten to where, I mean, I might have a glass of wine or something, but that's like a couple glasses maybe, but that's pretty much it, you know, like.
Yeah, I was going to ask if you're able to drink with the transplant afterwards, like, are you still able to enjoy like a glass of wine or something?
Yeah, I mean, that's not a bad thing for me. Like the doctors have even said like a glass of wine is not going to hurt me, but, what put me in the situation in the beginning was, you know, shooting up drugs and drinking a bottle of a fifth of vodka every single day. So I obviously can't do that anymore. Yeah. You know, I mean, like you said, you know, you're hungover and you wake up, I would wake up and just open up a fifth of vodka and kill that and probably have another one before the show. I mean, I've missed shows because of that. I've passed out on stage and, it's all stuff I'm not proud of, but it's shit that happens. It's another part of life, you know? So
yeah, it's hard, man. Like, you know, like being on the road, like not being in a comfortable situation because vans and trucks and whatever you're using to move around, like you're not getting enough sleep. You're not getting proper rest. You're going from city to city. You're also getting like, you know, fans hitting you up with like, hey, let me buy you a shot, man, you know, or something like that.
Yeah, that happens, you know. You just have to, now we've learned after, you know, this band's 32 years old, you know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, and we've been touring like most of those years since like 92 or something, we started touring. And it's just, there's ways now we figured out how to stay away from certain situations like that, you know? But once again, like I said, it's not easy. I see these like younger bands go on tour and they think they're supposed to do all that stuff, you know? But I mean, after, you know, days on the road and you've been drinking, it's not a good feeling. You just feel horrible all the time. And it's, I mean, if you can handle that, that's fine. But, you know, I'm not condemning it in any way. People can do whatever they want. I'm fine with whatever, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Did you have to go through like some kind of rehab type of deal for getting off of that, or what, did you just do it on your own and just deal with the withdrawals and all that?
I mean, I basically, right after Katrina, I got arrested for looting a pharmacy, and I kicked everything in jail. Then I was locked up for like 90 something days.
Damn.
But I got out though, and I had violated my probation, so they put me back in for like, I think it was like 6 weeks, 6 more weeks. But anyway, so I had kicked everything then, But the booze, man, the booze is just always there. You know, it's like always the go-to because it's everywhere and it's like socially acceptable to drink.
Yeah.
So, you know, that became a problem again and, you know, again and again, you know, when I would try to stop that. But it ended up, you know, just before my surgery, they just put me in the hospital and just kept me away from everything. And I just sat there for weeks. I was in the hospital like 3 months. They basically just, you know, I had no choice but to kick, you know, the alcohol at that point. I mean, I was basically off everything else, but that the booze is the one that, like, locked me up, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And that's, like you said, it's because it's so easily available. It's something that, you know, like, I enjoy drinking, but it's crazy to me that that is so easily available and so easily accessible, too. And, like, it's wild, you know. Booze kills a lot of people, not just from accidents and, you know, drunk drivers, but also just liver and kidney damage and, you know, colon cancer and all kinds of shit. And yet here it is. It's still like, you know, there's commercials with hot chicks pushing alcohol on you. You know what I mean? Like,
of course. Yeah. I mean, you know, we all grew up watching those commercials, you know, too. And it's like, oh, it's fun to drink and it's cool to drink. Mm-hmm. But then, I mean, when it gets to be an addiction to the point where it's an addiction, it's unstoppable. You're not drinking for fun anymore. You're drinking just so you feel better. You have a shot first thing in the morning because that's the only way you're going to feel better, you know?
Yeah.
And, of something that's easily available, you know, and, it just becomes a cycle and it does destroy your body. I mean, it, you know, I've seen it happen to myself. It just destroys you, you know?
Right. Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, but people are, you can't tell people anything, you know, and I certainly do not ever preach about anything like that. People are free to do whatever they want. I don't care what people do. Yeah. You know, it doesn't matter to me. I just know for a fact that years of doing that will affect you after time, you know.
For sure.
You know, people can do whatever they want.
Yeah, man. I'm with you. I don't judge anyone on their vices or whatever they're doing. You know, even when it comes to like religious shit, like I'm not religious, but you know, do you if that's what makes you happy, man. I don't know. But it freaks me out when I, you know, how do they select which drugs are acceptable? Like, how is it that alcohol and cigarettes and shit are easily available and promoted, but then like weed is condemned in so many states? Like, thankfully now more states are opening up to it, but like, you know, I find weed less harmful than booze, you know?
Oh, of course. I mean, marijuana should have been legal a long time ago. It's just, it goes with the person too. It's like some people can handle it and some people can't. So it's like, if it's used in a medical way that helps people, that's fantastic. It should have happened a long time ago. I never thought I would see the day when it was, you know, semi-legal in most states, you know, or the states that it is legal in. I mean, that's amazing. That's something I'm so glad that I can see.
Yeah, man.
But like,
yeah,
you said about what's acceptable, it's like, you know, booze and cigarettes, and then, you know, weed's got a stigma to it. But then there's, it's fine in some circles that cocaine is okay. But then when you tell them, and I've done my share of cocaine too, so, you know, I know all about it. But there's, then you know, somebody brings up heroin and the whole room's like, oh my God.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah, yeah.
Heroin. But it's like, you're doing cocaine and drinking vodka. That's going to kill you too. So, you know, there are all these things that exist on earth to elevate your consciousness and make you feel good. And it's strange that these things grow out of the ground, most of them, but that's just the way it is. I can't go any deeper into it than that because I don't know what it all means, but
yeah,
there's stigmas on certain things and these things aren't going away anytime soon. You know, it's like the war on drugs was just basically it was a big gimmick, you know.
Mm-hmm.
There's no way they'll ever stop drugs.
No, no.
Isn't there one?
It's funny that you brought that up. Like, I never thought of that, but that's true. Like, if you show up at a party and you're like, I got a little bit of coke, everybody's like, woo! But if you're like, hey, man, I got some heroin, everybody's like, wait, what? Stop. Like,
no, it's,
It's the same idea, you know?
Back in the 90s, I mean, me and Joey, our drummer that passed away, I mean, we would ask for heroin off from the stage, you know, like, has anybody here got any? And it's just, and people just look at you like you're completely insane. But after the show, those people are ready to give you a fucking key bump in a second, you know? And it's
right,
like,
right. Yeah.
They're all dangerous. It's all dangerous. And yeah, it makes you feel great and all for a little while, but it's all going to end in a bad way. But, you know, that's for people to decide themselves.
Sure, man. Have you adjusted your diet, like what you're eating because of the whole transplant? Like, do you have to go vegan or something? Or
no, I didn't have to go vegan, but I'm vegetarian right now, and I'm trying to go completely vegan. I don't even really eat eggs. I love cheese, though. I can't help eating cheese, but but I've pretty much cut out milk and eggs. No, it wasn't because of the transplant. It's just because it was time, you know? Like, I was vegetarian for about 5 or 6 years back in the 90s, and then it just ended up relapsing on that and going back and eating chicken. I never was a fan of red meat, you know? I find it disgusting, to be honest, red meat. I can't even barely look at it. But, I mean, I honestly think that this whole virus thing is possibly due to the fact of people eating animals, you know, and it seems like that practice is a little, I mean, humans are carnivores, they say, but we're also herbivores too. You can live a great life without eating meat, you know, there's no reason to eat that stuff. I mean, people enjoy it, that's great, no problem, I have no problem with that. Just personally, you know, I mean, there's this stuff called Impossible Burger now that it tastes exactly like ham. I mean, have you ever tried that stuff?
Yeah. I've had a couple. Yeah.
It's exact to the consistency, and it even has like the heme iron in it, which is like the taste of blood, but it's not blood. But I mean, I'm sure people listening to this, of course, somebody will, you know, disagree and say something, but whatever. I don't care about anybody.
Yeah, but, I mean, Burger King started doing Impossible Whoppers.
Yes, Burger King, who is a huge corporation that sucks, but still, though, that's great. There's a few places that are doing it, you know, and it's just a great alternative to not kill more animals and maybe try to keep the Earth the way it was supposed to be back before humans became a huge bacteria on the planet, you know?
Sure.
Because, I mean, that's where all these viruses are coming from, like people eating anteaters and bats and whatever else they're eating. And then these things, I mean, these things, it's a whole different species. You really, you know, people can do what they want, eat what they want. But I think that that this problem could possibly be from the animal industry and the beef industry and people going overboard with all that stuff. It's not good for the environment in any way. And we're seeing that right now in a way.
Yeah, man. It's weird when you like, I've been vegan, I've been vegetarian. Like right now I'm just kind of just eating healthy as I can.
Me too. That's what I do. I try.
But it's wild to me that there's people out there that are like, "Oh, I wonder what bat tastes like." Like why there's so many different preparations of like chicken, for example, or just cow. That like why do you have to go that route? Like why do you want wolf pups? You know, like come on.
Yeah, I mean, there's these assholes that go out and like hunt lions and things and like or kill an elephant or something and they want to like eat that. And it just doesn't make sense to me. Why they're killing these things in the first place doesn't make sense to me at all. I think they're assholes for it, but
yeah.
I don't know, man. I mean, I'm all for like if people hunt and that's a human thing. That's been going on since, you know, the caveman days. Humans hunt and they kill animals and they eat them. That's part of the humanity, you know? So, I mean, if people are going to hunt and kill these things and actually eat them to survive, that's fine, you know? But then when everything just starts it's become like this huge, like mechanized fucking, death factory type of thing where they, they're breeding these things. Like, I mean, like reading all the stuff that just happened recently about animals, just that since all the industries have closed and, for the coronavirus, that they're like just slaughtering like all these animals that were bred for the purpose of humans to eat. And now they're, since they can't sell the meat, they're just killing them and just throwing them. I don't know where they're putting this stuff, but
that's crazy.
It's just it's a complete waste. And these animals were only bred to be killed in the first place, They put like 20 chickens in a tiny cage and they try to fatten them up and they shoot all these vitamins and chemicals into them to make them taste a certain way. And I think it's pretty horrible, to be honest,
Mm-hmm. And people don't, it's funny how they don't consider that all that shit that they're injecting is eventually going to end up inside of them. Like you're putting all that in the animal and then you're going to eat the animal that's going into you. I don't know.
Yes. I mean, I'm not so well spoken on the whole thing about it, but those are the things I believe.
Is there a lot of options in New Orleans for vegetarian like restaurants and stuff? Because I know the food in New Orleans is incredible. I mean,
of course.
Few things I had out there were amazing.
Yeah, of course, man. I mean, there's vegetarian restaurants everywhere now. That's the thing about today. It's like, it's 2020, there's stuff everywhere. There's a brand called Gardenia that does like, fake chicken. And I mean, when you say fake chicken, it sounds like shit, but it's really good. Like they're plant-based products, like Impossible Burger and that Gardenia, but there's just alternatives. I think people should at least try to, if they hate it, then that's fine. Cool. You can hate whatever you want. That's not my problem. But people should at least try to quit eating so much meat. It's just disgusting to me. But that's just me. That's one man's opinion right there.
Yeah, man. I wanted to ask you about your in your personal life. Like now that you're spending more time at home, not on the road and shit. What are you? Are you watching anything? Are you been binge watching shit like people have been on Netflix, or are you just writing?
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, just like everybody else. I mean, I try to read, I've got so many books. I'm like in the middle halfway through that I need to finish. And, I end up like, on YouTube or like Netflix watching, any documentary about crime and drugs are my favorite. Those are my favorite ones.
Nice.
And, like recently, I just finally got into Narcos, which I haven't, I didn't watch until recently. So it's great. And, I'm fascinated by all that stuff, but I also like end up on YouTube watching like old, like New York Dolls videos and Stooges and Dead Boys and bands like that. And I don't listen to anything though. Like my taste in music goes all over the place. So that's, I never run out of things to watch or listen to, but I've been writing, like I said, and doing what everybody else is doing, just trying to keep busy.
Yeah.
And not bored,
Sure. Yeah. Are there any newer bands that that you've heard recently that you're into? Hello?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay.
I was just trying to think, like, newer bands, I can't really, off the top of my head right now, I don't even really know of any brand new bands, but I've listened to a lot of new bands lately. Like, I'll go on Spotify, and there's a band that I like, and then you scroll down, and there's, similar bands, similar artists. And I'll just, go through those and listen to everything, Most of the stuff I listen to is older, I would say.
Okay.
I mean, I listen to everything, from Pink Floyd to Exodus and Slayer to old hardcore or bands like Laughing Hyenas. There's this band called Leatherface from the UK that I like a lot. Poison Idea. There's so many things out there. As far as new bands, I can't even think of anything off the top of my head. I know as soon as we hang up, I'll think about it.
Yeah, man. So you've been.
I just did an interview for Metal Insider, which was I think I posted it and stuff on my Instagram somewhere. But I listed a bunch of bands in there that like newer bands that I'm listening to.
Okay, cool. So I'll check that out.
Yeah, yeah.
Once this whole thing kind of blows over and you know touring gets back you know into effect. Is there any like bands that you want to tour with that you like want to prepare a tour package with?
Oh fuck! I mean, Discharge again because when Discharge are one of my favorite bands ever since like literally, and I'll show my age kind of, but like since like 1981, I bought a Discharge record in 1981 and. Fucking fell in love with that band and I wasn't so big on their metal phase in the 80s late 80s but they're a great band and I Hate God toured with Discharge but Randy Blythe was the singer for that tour because I was in the hospital. That's when I was like right before I got my surgery, so I couldn't make that tour. I couldn't do the tour, so nicely enough, our friend Randy, stepped in and did those shows. But I'm still jealous that I didn't get to tour with Discharge. Right. So hopefully one day like we can set that back up again. Since they're still Discharge are kicking again. I mean, they kind of slowed down back in the day, and but they've got this new singer, JJ, and they sound great as ever. But as far as other bands, I mean, the bands I want to tour with are, like, kind of gone, you know, like Motorhead or Poison Idea. I just saw Poison Idea's last show recently. They did their last show in Brooklyn, and it was fucking great. But, shit, man. I mean, the last tour we did with Napalm Death was amazing. We're definitely going to go back out with Napalm Death.
Nice.
They're super cool guys, and the tour was a lot of fun. And there's some other guys on that tour. This band called Bat, which is a couple guys from Municipal Waste.
Yep.
But Bat are more of that like Venom. Venom's another band I'd love to tour with. I'm a huge Venom fan. I love Venom.
Nice.
Whatever incarnation they are. At the time, they're great. But so, yeah, I mean, there's so much stuff that it's hard to even, you know, my head explodes when you ask me about music. I don't even know which direction to go in.
Yeah, man. No, I hope that all this blows over soon so I can see you guys again. I've seen you guys a bunch of times. I mean, I remember seeing you at I went out to Denver for the Great American Beer Festival when I was working in the beer industry, and like all my beer friends were like, yeah, we're going to go to this house and we're going to drink these beers, or like, hey, we're going to this bar and we're going to drink beer all night. And I'm like, well, I'm going to be drinking beer all day at the festival. I'm going to go do something else. And one of my buddies was like, hey, I Hate God's playing down the road. I'm like, what? Let's go. And I saw it was you guys, a chemist, and I remember who else.
In Denver, I'm trying to think of which one that was. That wasn't, Valiant Thor, was that outdoors?
Maybe? No, it was indoors. That? It was indoors. I think Valiant Thor.
I remember chemist. That show. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I remember that show.
And I just remember thinking,
kind of a
like,
weird show.
Yeah, it was a weird show, but it still felt awesome to me because it felt like a piece of, because like all my beer friends, none of them were metalheads. You know, they were all like, yeah, we're just going to drink beer and chill. But like the fact that was happening, I felt so at home that, you know, being able to hang out there.
Well, that's what I was going to say, that those beer festivals turn out kind of strange. We've played a lot of them. Mm. We've done the Dark Lord Day. We did one in Wisconsin not that long ago with the Black Lips. I think it was Wisconsin. But anyway, those beer fests are strange because there's all these people there. Like it's like sold out, but only like, you know, 8% of them even know who we are as a band. Like they're just there for the beer.
Right.
And
right.
It's just like this crowd is just there and they're just worried about what the new, you know, pale ale is going to taste like for that year. And they don't really care about the music that much. There are people there definitely to see the bands.
Yeah.
We did that Dark Lord Day Fest a bunch. Like that's right outside of Chicago.
Yeah. They're and, cool though. Cause they always support metal bands too. That Dark Lord.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They've done everybody. They've had Sleep play. I believe. I know they had, maybe it was High on Fire. They did High on Fire. They've done the Melvins. They did I Hate God. There's been a bunch of people at that fest. So they're definitely more oriented, whatever the word is, to for that style of music, you know. Yeah. And we played this one not that long ago, like I was saying, with the Black Lips. And it was this huge festival, and they paid us really well, I must say. And there was literally, like, no one at this festival. It was really strange. I don't know if it was the day that we were there, it was winding down or something, but it was just like, I guess this beer company just gives them all this money and says, here, put bands on that you want to see. So somebody was a fan of us. I mean, like we played with the Black Lips, who are not, you know, they're kind of garagey pop stuff. Yeah. They're great guys, cool people, and a good band, but it was just a strange concept the whole day.
Yeah, I always find those type of shows fascinating, where like they pick a band like you guys, and then like, you know, a Black Lips or, you know, something that doesn't fit the, like, you're gonna scare the audience, you know, whatever side of it is. Like if it's I Hate God fans and they you know, you bring out this like garage pop band, whether they're good or not, like they're still gonna be like, maybe it's time to go to the bathroom, you know, or maybe it's time for a break. Like, you know, I mean, I've done that before. I've been to festivals where,
yeah,
you know, two or three of the bands are something I want to see, and then there's a few others that I'm just like, well, this is when I go chill somewhere else and go get some food or something, you know?
Sure, yeah. I mean, it's good for like a mixed bill, you know, thing. It's just, I don't know, it all depends, you know? But, yeah.
Do you ever go to NAMM? Have you been to NAMM?
I've been to NAMM once, and I was so drunk that I caused a bunch of trouble and, like, ended up being told to stay outside. But yeah, so I've been.
Oh, man. Yeah. NAMM is trouble, because either you're there to be nerdy and look at a bunch of new gear, or you're there to party with everyone from out of town.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a rough go.
Well, that was like, I was like heavy boozing at the time. And we just showed up and started like spreading. We for some reason, we told everyone that Chris Holmes from Wasp was dead. We were just spreading the, I don't know what made us do that, but we were just like telling people this and starting this rumor. But then it gradually got worse, and we had like we did a signing. We did like a meet and greet type thing there. Mm-hmm. And they had like 8x10s printed out for us to sign. It was because we were sponsored by Lace Pickups, you know, Jimmy and Brian, and they were using Lace Pickups. So they brought us there, and I was just a fucking mess. So I ended up apologizing to Lace, you know, later, like, yeah, sorry about that. I mean, it wasn't that bad, but it was bad enough to where I was asked like not to be around and sober up a little bit. But it was fun though. I remember it being fun, you know, so.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, hey man, I appreciate you taking some time to talk to me today. I know that.
I wanted to tell you a couple things though.
Yeah. Yeah. Go for it.
I did this thing last night on Cult Nation website. There's a website called Cult Nation. It's like everything dark and heavy on this website. And I did like a spoken word piece thing last night. If people want to go check that out, it's on YouTube and they can find it under Cult Nation with Mike Nine, you know.
Is the Cold Nations with a V, right? They use the V instead of the U? Yeah.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, CVLT. And then, Yeah, and there's this band Hara. I just did I did vocals on a track.
Oh, nice.
For them. Yeah, so that's what I've been doing lately in writing. So I just wanted to get those things out there.
For sure. Yeah, I'm looking at the Instagram right now of Cult Nation. They have video clip, like a minute clip of a.
They have a teaser.
There.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you go to YouTube, the whole thing's there. It's like 10 minutes. You know, it's just something people can check out. It's like just what I've been doing recently, and there'll be more stuff like that soon. I just doing things, you know, by myself here to keep busy. So that's just one of the pandemic. Performances I've done, so
survive,
people want to check it out.
Survive if you must, but I don't care if you do.
Yeah, it's just my words, my opinions, and some abstract thinking there. But I just wanted to throw that in at the end.
Hell yeah, man! No, check that out on Cold Nation. I mean, I'm looking forward to the new I Hate God. You know. Assuming everything gets back to, or at least the studios open back up in like a couple weeks, you know, when do you think you can wrap up the album?
I mean, as soon as I can get into a studio and start working on it, you know, I'm looking around right now to find somebody that's. I mean, it would have to be like a total social distancing thing. Like it'd have to be like two people in the studio, but I'd rather do it when it's a little more chilled out and we don't have to be that precautious, but I guess that's going to be years from now. So it's going to get done either way, you know, sooner or later.
Writing wise, you said you had most of the songs kind of written. I mean, are your parts written and
all
ready
the
to go?
The music's done. All the music is completely, except for mixing it and all that, the music's done. I just, I have massive lyrics. I have lyrics. Like I said, I write almost every day from at least a few lines. You know, I've been writing since forever. So I've got stuff I haven't used from years ago. And I have like at least like two or three books. I could put out that probably many. There's like over probably 30,000 words, you know, just has to be edited and put together and all that. But yeah, there's definitely lyrics there for new songs, for new I Hate God songs. And always can always write more. So that's deal.
And you got on your website, www.mikeix.com, you know, for people that
Mike Nine. Yeah. Well, I have to say that website's fucked up right now, to be honest.
Okay.
It needs maintenance. It hasn't been, I actually haven't even been to the website in a while because it kind of just fell apart. Like I haven't really even looked at it since it's been a while. So the store's shut down on it because I need to have maintenance on that, and the whole site needs an overload. So also, if anybody out there listening wants to help me build a new website, and also donate money to me, please.
You have a link on there for the donation that youcaring.com/Mike9Williams 69-695-413. But
wait, what was that? I don't even know what that is. That's old. That's ancient.
That's old, right? Okay, that's on your website. So let's not.
Yeah, the website. Yeah, the website's garbage. I really think it is. It's over with. I need to redo the whole thing. The new I have a PayPal address on the YouTube Cult Nation video. Okay. It's stockton.lono@gmail.com. Yep. That's a PayPal address somebody can, if they want to hit me up. And I'm going to be putting out another book as soon as I can and repressing my old book and et cetera, et cetera.
Hell yeah, man. If you guys are listening, donate. Mike's, you know, you're an incredible talent and, you know, you've been through some shit.
Thank you.
You've had your medical bills and you know, and obviously now this current situation is not easy, not being able to tour. So anything helps, donate.
Yeah, we're all in this together, man. This, you know, these, you know, like musicians and gig workers and such are kind of the odd people out right here, because no one has, like, a lot of people don't even have check stubs or things like that to show for taxes and things. So it's been a harder to get the unemployment and stuff like that. But
yeah,
just support everyone.
For sure, man. For sure. All right, brother. Yeah. Well, hey, stay safe. You know, we'll be in touch. You know, I have your number and everything. We'll stay in touch. And, you know, hopefully when you guys get back out on the road, I'll come say what's up and see you guys once more.
Yeah, cool, man. We'll see you there.
All right, brother. Take care. Cheers.
All right. Thanks, man.